Welcome back to another episode of the Meaningful People Podcast, episode number
18.
I think it's 18, yeah. Hi. Episode number 18, we sat down with the awesome Rabbi YY Rubinstein.
Yeah, he's our first international, well, not international, but our first Scottish guest. He's originally from Scotland.
And he might be our only Scottish guest, unless anybody out there has any ideas.
Yeah, but like we mentioned in the outro for Shimei Dar's episode, Rabbi YY is one of the most interesting people I've ever seen. This episode is filled with laughs, chizik, stories, inspiration.
And some cries.
Yeah.
So give a listen.
Yeah.
Hope you enjoy. And again, a shout out to our people at AMR Pharmacy. We love you. You love us. And all you viewers and listeners love them too. So check them out. 848-222-1110. 848-222-1110. The pharmacy of the future. Enjoy.
Welcome to the Meaningful People Podcast, the podcast where we talk to people who are...
meaningful.
Yeah, that sounds good. We are here with Rav Yehuda Yoina Rubinstein, also known as Your Holiness, as you just mentioned right before.
Also known as Reb YY Rubinstein.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That covers all the names?
No.
There's more?
Well, my mother-in-law calls me different names.
Oh, okay.
That's there we go. Yeah. So you're originally from Scotland.
I am.
Yeah. I'm just going to say move that. Drop. Close. Sorry.
Yes, I am.
You could hold it if you prefer, but you probably don't prefer.
I don't prefer.
No. I would say take it off.
No, I feel like Frank Sinatra. You know?
So you're originally from Scotland.
Yes.
And now you're in America, but what was that like growing up in Scotland?
Violent.
Really?
Extraordinarily violent. Glasgow, I was born in 1955, and when I left Glasgow, when I was 19, there were more murders in the first 3 months of the year than there was in Northern Ireland at the height of the Civil War.
Wow. Either not a lot of people died in the Civil War.
No, a lot of people died.
Okay. Wow.
It was extremely violent.
So it was a scary place to grow up.
Very, very.
Do you miss it? Do you ever like...
dying? No. I went to a non-Jewish school because there was in Glasgow. It's a very... I've got the great pleasure of traveling all over the world, as you know. Just drop that in. Hi, sorry. And speaking to communities all over the place. Glasgow, my hometown, is the only one I know, Jewishly speaking, that never quite managed to put together any Jewish education, meaningful education at all.
To this date?
To this day. Even worse, it managed to have, the only thing they came up with was an elementary school called Calderwood Lodge. Perfect. And Calderwood Lodge. And and an elementary school. It was actually, probably still is, written in the constitution of the school. No rabbis allowed to set foot over the front door.
That's anti-Semitic.
Thank you.
That's not so politically correct.
Yeah. Not politically correct. And anyway, so basically, is that nobody, well, I suppose some people did, but lots of people didn't send their kids there because you actually get more Jewish education at a non-Jewish school than the Jewish school that doesn't want any rabbis there.
Well,
yeah. So together with, I mean, Ramatasiel Solomon, whom you will know, he didn't go to a Jewish school. The Roshi of Gates at a Reform Gurubitz didn't go to a Jewish school. I was once sitting at a table in Chicago, a simcha. Who was there? Professor Tversky, Abram Tversky, Rabbi Beryl Wein, and others.
I want them on a podcast. Yeah, you want them.
They're dropping right now.
Yeah. So some young fellow came across in some kollel, and he wanted some advice about some kids in a non-Jewish school. So they all looked at each other. So what do you mean they were in a non-Jewish school? Can they say the Lord's Prayer? Do they know the Lord's Prayer? Because they didn't go to Jewish schools either.
So you're in good company.
Yeah. it was a different century and a different place.
Right.
It just wasn't, but thank God, I mean, today the choices are enormous.
There's so many choices.
I know, which means, of course, we can all be, you know, snobby about it. I'm not sending to that Jewish school. where I grew up, there was no Jewish school.
But you mentioned that you're coming up in your 1-year anniversary of being an American citizen?
Oh, absolutely, yes, yes.
Do you know the national anthem by heart?
Yes, I'm one of the few people who can do that.
I do not know. Is that
a test to become a citizen, or is that like a fifth?
Yes, it is. You have to learn it. And I was very disappointed, actually, because at the end, it was like, it's a huge thing. There's about 200 people there. I was the only Jew. It was the only Jew. And anyway, so basically at the end, I was all ready to go, and they didn't sing it. What? And I felt miffed because I'd learned this off my heart. But it's also the facts that they ask you. And it's quite clear that to become an American citizen, you have to have the IQ, the average IQ, of a teaspoon of mayonnaise. This is absolutely true. In the booklet of the facts you have to learn, listen to this. I can't remember the number of that. I think it's question 56. What's the name of the ocean on the west coast of America?
Okay, I do not have a teaspoon of mayonnaise.
You a teaspoon of mayonnaise?
I think you go for it now.
It's Pacific.
Yeah, it is Pacific.
Oh, yeah, duh, of course.
Then,
yeah.
The next question, what's the name of the ocean on the east coast of America?
Yeah, you got this.
It's not the Pacific.
You got this.
Begins with the E?
So let's talk about, you moved to Gateshead after. I don't know these things. I'm so privileged.
You're surrounded by here. Atlantic.
I hope my parents aren't listening to this. Atlantic. Atlantic. Yeah, of course, Atlantic.
I've done
scuba diving in the Atlantic.
Did you really?
Many times.
You, by the way,
I'm a scuba diver.
Really?
Yeah, let's jump right in. You have some incredible stories from.
I mean, under the sea or over the sea?
Both.
A lot. You have in the sea, in the sky, with lions, with the queen.
Yeah.
Where do we start?
I think we should start with.
The queen was not with the lion. Or under the sea.
Okay, so let's start.
Yeah. No, let's start with.
Let's
start with you. You were on a flight going
I was in South Africa. It was my first ever trip to Africa, to South Africa. I used to go there lecturing at least once a year, sometimes twice a year. From England, of course, it's not so far.
Right.
Well, it's far that way. But the crucial factor of time difference, it's not so far because you're not going through. Time zones. Mm. So you didn't arrive. It's a 1 hour time zone difference. So when you arrived, you weren't so shattered, if that's the word, as if you're flying, from here to England or South Africa from here, which I did 2 years ago. And horrible. Anyway, I was in South Africa and I was having a lovely time and I had to fly from Johannesburg to Durban on the East Coast. Now, if you don't know the name of the ocean over there.
Atlantic and Pacific.
Go.
Hello,
this was the Indian Ocean. Durban's on the Indian Ocean, right? Over there.
That one I didn't know.
It's over there.
Okay.
It's not New York.
Got it.
Just focus it. It's not New York.
Just plead the fifth.
Not America. Got it. Yeah.
Not America. Yeah. Not anything outside New York.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyway. So basically, I was late taking off. I'm a very nervous person when I fly. Mm. Just strange, because I do it all the time. I'm not nervous because of plane crashes. I'm nervous about missing flights. So if they tell me to be at the airport 2 hours before, I get there 4 hours before. I arrived very early, and the screen said that the flight was delayed by half an hour. It was not a problem. They told me the entire community of Durban would be turning out to hear me, and South African Jews are very remarkable. An entire country became Bali Tshuva. An entire country. And when I was there on one of my trips, they closed the last remaining Reform synagogue. I mean, they're just, if they're not religious, they know that what they shouldn't be keeping are Orthodox laws. But those are the laws that you should keep, even if they're not keeping. Anyway, so basically I arrived at the airport, half hour delay, no problem. Went to the board after half an hour, delayed by another half an hour. And then another half an hour and another half an hour. And now it's getting a problem. And that was very touch and go whether I was going to be getting there on time for the entire community who was turning out to hear me.
Right. Is that Sinai and Dawi you were speaking at?
No. That, 2 years ago was, okay. But this is just me in those days.
Okay,
just
that's amazing.
The country to myself. We got onto the plane. And when we got on the plane, I always choose, incidentally, a window seat. There are three reasons for this. The first reason is, I don't know if you know this, you can often tell the country you're flying over by the shape and the color of the fields. Did you know that?
No. I mean, Yaakov, you didn't know the Pacific Ocean was.
You didn't know that.
Yeah, so that.
But Naki's pretending he did.
Okay. I honestly didn't even hear what you said.
Now, if you fly to England and then you fly across to France, the fields are the same shape and color. But if your plane turns right and you go down to Spain, as soon as you cross the Pyrenees, those are mountains, that separate the two countries.
Yeah, the Pyrenees River, of course.
You're making us sound so intelligent. Right.
I know, oh my God. Also, with your accent, you sound so much smarter than... I mean, you're probably also very smart, but your accent makes us sound very dumb.
So you're able to see when you cross over different countries. That's
I've never
exciting.
Seen African fields. I wanted to see African fields. I was like a window scene. Also, of course, I never really grew up, so the fun. And so, anyway, I was sitting in my window seat, and the captain...
Wait, there's three reasons why you sit in the window seat.
Yeah, there was the other reason I like the window seat.
The third one.
You
don't have to get up for the first time.
Yeah, that's something. Anyways, I can't remember.
Okay. We'll go with that one.
We'll go with that. Anyway, so basically, there I was, and the captain spoke to the ladies and gentlemen. It was a British Airways flight. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the captain speaking. Must apologize for the late departure of your flight, but this was due to an engine failure, and we couldn't take off until the part was replaced. Good. Given the adverse weather conditions, they said, we couldn't take off until the part was replaced. I thought, even if it's a sunny day, what a good idea to not go until the broken part is replaced in the engine. Anyway, he said, our cruising altitude will be 35,000 feet. Our flight time will be 55 minutes. Please sit back and relax. I'll speak to you during the flight. Fine. So I sat there, and I was thinking, gosh, look at that. As I was watching all that. Oh, that's the other reason. I find the airports very intriguing places.
You mean to taxi through?
Yeah, no, just all these strangely shaped vehicles.
And people going like this.
And that's right. Yeah. And the flashing signs. It is all very interesting. Anyway, we got onto the runway. There was three parallel yellow lines painted on the side of the runway. And I remember thinking, whoa, what's that for? Why yellow? Why three? Right? Anyway, so as we took off, or we started to move down and pick up speed across along the runway, the three yellow lines started to become two yellow lines. And I thought, wow, what's that? What's that about? I thought maybe that's to tell the pilot the point at which he should be lifting up the nose and taking off. And then I noticed that he wasn't lifting up the nose and taking off. I remember distinctly thinking, I hope it's a very long runway. And the plane was shaking like crazy. But anyway, we took off. And I looked out the window. It was getting dark, but I could see at last African fields, and you should be intrigued to know they're very different to American or European fields. And then I went into a little daydream about what will I say when I get there? Will I give this lecture or that lecture or this talk? And after about 10 minutes, I decided what I was going to talk about. Still getting dark, I looked out, but there was no doubt whatsoever that African fields are totally different. And then a thought came into my mind. How come you can still see the fields? What happened to 35,000 feet? 35,000 feet, you can't see the fields. And then our pilot spoke to us again, and he said, ladies and gentlemen, this is your pilot speaking. There's nothing to worry about. Now, you two guys are young, so let me give you some advice, some sage advice. And that is, there are certain professions that use certain key phrases you should be alert to. For example, if your doctor tells you, you may be experiencing... this is exciting. Oh, you unplugged it. if your doctor tells you, you may experience some discomfort.
Right.
That means acute agony, right? When your dentist tells you they're only going to be a few more minutes, it means you're going to be writhing the chair for half an hour. When your lawyer tells you it won't cost you much, it means you're bankrupt. And when your pilot tells you there's nothing to worry about, it means that he thinks that you're going to die.
Okay.
And in this particular case, what we had nothing to worry about was the fact we'd lost the front wheels on takeoff.
What?
And with my superior rabbinic brain, I remember thinking to myself, oh, that's okay. We're up. And only after that did it come into my mind, how do you get down again? Anyway, so we're flying around. It was Elo. We're flying around for half an hour just around the airport because they knew that he knew as soon as we took off, he'd lost the front wheels. And we're getting getting the runway ready for the crash landing.
This is at the destination? This is like in...
No, we didn't go anywhere. We just flew around Johannesburg Airport as they got the runway ready for the crash landing with all the fire trucks and the foam and all that stuff.
Wow.
Like you see in the movies.
So how was that? Yeah.
That was... There's the funny version and there's the serious version. At the time, it was really quite serious. I was quite convinced I was going to die. And as I had two little girls, age 4 and 7 at the time, I thought it got very... emotional at the thought of them growing up not knowing who the father was.
This is very scary.
Yeah. We moved us from the seat. We're all moved into the front of the aircraft. Sorry, the back of the aircraft, because you want to get as much weight off the front as you possibly can when you don't have any wheels there anymore. Then they prepare you for the crash landing, which is not the usual stuff. You know, tie it in a double bow at the side. Now this is serious. They make you take off your shoes. They make you take off your glasses if you wear glasses. Take off your tie, and you have to practice the crash or the brace position, which is put your hands on your head and press your head as hard as you can into the seat in front of you. So not only are you going to die, but you're going to get a sore neck at the same time.
Oh, man.
Yes. And so it's actually got quite serious. But so there's a funny bit to it. So I was in a plane crash.
Hold on. What? You're alive. So
he's here.
Yeah, what
you're
happened? Here. Hold on.
What happened? We had a crash landing. So we came down. I don't know how he managed this, but he kept the plane on the runway. And then, the high spot. The escape slide. I'd always wanted to do the escape slide, yeah.
That so is a dream.
And that was that.
And you went down that slide.
I went down
the slide. But you were convinced that you were going to die.
Yeah. It's actually very important. It's one of the most important things that ever happened to me in my life, because I now know what that process is like and how that I'm not in the slightest scared of dying. How you die, that's a different matter. Nobody wants to die in pain. So the word euthanasia comes from two Greek words, euthantos, meaning good death. Everybody wants a good death, not a painful death. But the actual idea of dying, that doesn't really trouble me at all. And I know that because I nearly did.
Because of this experience?
For an hour, I was preparing to die.
You were able to see.
I was able to see.
Is it too personal to ask how you prepared yourself for that?
Well, first of all, I thought to myself, because I'm really very clever, I thought, maybe it'd be a good time to say Tehillim. So I did that. And then Shema. And then Vido. That's when it really got quite emotional.
Wow.
And I'll have to tell you something, that really at that stage, I was very happy, happily married to my late wife, Alessia. I had gorgeous kids, still have. However, when it really gets to that stage, it's just you and the boss. It really is just you and the boss. Obviously, you would miss my kids and stuff like that, but it's just you and God. And that's a very important thing to bear in mind.
Wow, that's crazy. I kind of want to sit on this, but you have so many crazy stories that happen to you. And we'll get into your past with Gates at Yeshiva and then college campus rabbi. But the Queen of England asked to meet you. So for Americans, that's like, oh, cool, like President Trump. But like, I think it's in Europe, it's like huge. Like that, what happened there?
Well, I have for something like 30 years been a broadcaster and writer of scripts for the BBC.
Which is also very interesting.
What does BBC stand for?
British Broadcasting Corporation.
Okay, that's very simple.
Yes, that's easy. And it's the largest broadcaster in the world. When I broadcast, I've done it for a long time now, for BBC World Service, your minimum audience is 156 million.
So it's pretty much what we're doing right now.
You've gone out, I'm just going to say, it's like this podcast.
That camera has 156.
That's a very large number of people. Obviously a very large number of Jews as well are going to be listening to you. I remember once, the only Jews do this. I broadcast in the BBC World Service. Out it went. And then within 4 hours, I get a phone call from somebody in Zimbabwe. No, you're not going to know what that is, are you?
I've heard of Zimbabwe.
Go.
I've heard of Zimbabwe.
It's Africa. It's just north of South Africa.
How weird is? I have no clue.
It's north of South Africa. On the east, that's Zimbabwe.
Do they have their own fields also there?
I've never been to Zimbabwe. But some Jewish guy in Zimbabwe, actually in Bulawayo.
What?
There's another city called Bulawayo.
Blue
Whale.
Staying afterwards.
Bulawayo. It's actually short for Goot Bulawayo, which means the place of the great slaughter. Just like to know.
Jewish slaughter?
Great. Okay. Anyway, so there's a Jewish guy living there, and he heard the broadcast, and he liked it, so he wanted to speak to me. You see, if you hear something on the radio or TV, you think, oh, that's really good. How would you get in touch? You wouldn't think, I'll get in touch with the guy, but you're Jewish. So he phoned his cousin in London. Do you know this guy, Rabbi YY Rubinstein? Yeah, he lives in Manchester. Oh, how can I get in touch with him? Let me phone somebody in Manchester. I'll get back to you. So he phones somebody in Manchester, phones somebody else, gets my phone number, passes it way back down the line. And within 2 hours, the guy says, hey, Louis, this is Rabbi Wawa. I just heard you on the World Service. Thought you were very good. Only Jews would do that.
Yeah.
So what did you talk about when you were working for the... Well, you still work for the BBC. What do you...
Oh, various things. I mean, various things. Funny things sometimes. Political things that was going on. I don't do that anymore because I'm not in the country. So at the moment, I do sort of religious stuff and write them scripts.
Jewish religion or...
I don't know.
It could be Christian.
Yeah, Zulu. Jewish religious stuff. And so I'll be doing 4 little scripts for them. And I often go into Manhattan and broadcast from the BBC studios in Manhattan.
That's really cool. Hold on. So the Queen of England.
So I used to be on all the time. So the largest radio show. Radio's huge in the UK. People get all the news from radio, BBC radio. And so the big news program in the morning is 3 hours. The prime ministers listen to this and the politicians listen to this. And of course, the Queen does. So I used to be a regular in that. And that's 16 million people in that show. Listening to that show, which in a country of 64 million people is a very large proportion, right?
That's pretty good.
So basically, when she came, we were just moving here 10 years or so ago, and Her Majesty the Queen came to Manchester, and she spent the morning with the Jewish community. She's very fond of Jews. And she shook hands with the president of the Jewish community, and she said, is Rabbi YY here? And he said, no, ma'am.
Oh, what a pity. We listen to all the time on the radio, and we think he's awfully good.
Wow. So anyway, so the Queen actually has to meet me.
In American accent, that would be like, he's sick.
Yeah, he's sick. So awesome.
So did you meet the Queen?
No, we moved here.
What?
I know. We moved here.
That's not a good ending.
What did it feel like for you when you heard that she said that?
Well, I think she is a very good person. She's 94, I think, at the moment. Still going strong, which is absolutely amazing. And she... You can't say this about all the members of the royal family, sadly, as you probably know if you keep up with the news.
Yeah.
But she has never put a foot wrong, and she has taken her duty to her people and to the Commonwealth, you know, all that sort of stuff very, very seriously. And I think she's a very good person. So I was very, very flattered and very honored that Her Majesty the Queen would actually want to meet me.
You never thought about going back just to meet her?
Yeah, Papa Arthur, hi. Hi, Liz.
Well,
she wanted to meet you.
She subscribes to the podcast. So I'm Queenie, sure, yeah, hey, yeah, how's it going?
Yeah, hello, Queenie.
You're not allowed to say that.
How are the corgis doing?
Wow, that's really interesting and really cool. Something else interesting about you, now if you mention this, I don't know if he's making it up or not, but you got bitten by a wild animal.
By a lion.
By a lion.
Yeah.
I feel like you're a book.
You
want
to see the scar here?
Yeah.
Can you see that one there?
Yeah.
Right. And there's one under there. I can see.
He's showing us his arm.
I'm showing my arm here. Well, something.
And he has.
There's one
like,
on, I can't see. Scars. There's one there. So it was like that. And boom. Yeah.
What happened?
What's worse, the plane accident or the lion? Like, did you say you did it twice?
Yeah, no, this is funny. We were doing a student weekend. So there was 200 students, and we went away to some. If I remember rightly, it was a hotel in a place called the Drachensberg Mountains. Excuse me. I think I got the frog out my throat now. No, I haven't. Anyway, so basically, afterwards, on the way back, the people I was staying with felt sorry that I hadn't had the opportunity to see the African countryside. So that just about an hour and a half north of Johannesburg, there is a lion park. So we arrived at Lion Park. This was the year of the first non-apartheid Nelson Mandela government. He was also a very exceptional person. And he didn't ask to meet me. That's a tragedy for him. Anyway, so basically, we arrived there, and they gave out a brochure. And on the picture in the front was a little, beautiful little girl, white girl with golden hair, because obviously from the old regime. And she was nestling in her arms a fluffy little ball. And this fluffy little ball was a lion cub. Mm. And you could get your picture taken with the lion cubs. This was the same trip that I was in the plane crash, by the way.
What a year.
Yeah, what a trip that was. And I went back, weird. Anyway, so
honey, I'm home.
I hope. Well, part of me is. Anyway, so we went around, and I thought, this is great. I'll get a picture taken with me, Fluffy Ball, Daddy Van Lanken. And there was 200 students as well. and the family I was staying with, and their little boy, who was, I think, 9 at the time. And I promised him he'd get a picture taken with me and the lion cubs. Anyway, we went past, and the lions are big, big things. And you go and you drive past the lions. The brochure said, do not drive too quickly. The lions do not like this. And then they bite your tires. And then they eat you. So we drove very slowly. And eventually, after we saw the real lions, we went to the tourist area where you could get your picture taken with the lion cubs. However, when we arrived there, it was a big cage. And there was a sign saying that the brochure had explained they separate the lion cubs when they're born from the rest, the pride, the rest of the lions, because the father lion can accidentally kill its cub. Right? Mm. If it goes for a piece of meat, it'll grab it and break its back. And they reintroduce them back to the pack, what's actually called a pride, when they're 6 months old.
What do they do before zoos? Like, they're just killing their babies?
Yeah, probably, yeah. Anyway, so basically, this is not a zoo, it's a big park.
Okay.
Anyway, so we arrived there at the cage where there were 3 lion cubs. This is where you got your picture taken. However, the sign said that they were due for re-release back to the pride that day. Have you any idea what lion cub, what size it is at 6 months old?
I'd say like this big.
No.
This big?
For those listening, Nahi's holding his hands. Yeah, keep going. 4 feet?
It's the same size.
This is 4 feet?
3. Right. I don't know. Feet. Yeah. I don't know. Oceans. No, I don't know.
It's about the same size as a German Shepherd. Fully grown
wow.
German Shepherd.
Wow. Okay. That's not small. That's not big.
Anyway, so here, so there was 3 you. Of them, and a little hill in the middle, and they were sitting there looking very bored, like lions do. And all the students all gathered round about the cage. And this was not what I had in mind. So the problem was I'd promised the 9-year-old I'd take him in for a picture with the lions. And I didn't want to look like a chicken in the eyes of a 9-year-old.
You want to look like the Lion King?
Well, actually, what I didn't want to do was to look like a chicken in the eyes of a lion. So we went in. There was an attendant, but he was having his sandwiches. He was bored. He was outside. So we went in, and there was a hill. There was 3 lions there. 1, 2, 3. And I sat there, and the little boy sat beside me. And all the students are taking pictures. And I was not so sure about this. Now, I worked out with my superior intellect that a lion cub is just a great big pussycat. All you have to do is to deploy pussycat psychology, and you've cracked it. So I leant over to the lion, and I started to tickle it behind the ear. While I'm going,
I'd also bite you, by the way.
And it went, like this, and I went, ah. The students went, look, it nearly bit him. And they're all taking pictures. They thought it was hilarious. And I'm sort of like going, ah. Anyway, in came the attendant, a little black guy. And then he came, and he came over to me, and he said in his South African accent, which is African South African accent, would you like to get your picture taken, kid, in Langup, sir?
I missed that.
What? Slowing that down, would you like to get your picture taken carrying the lion cub, sir? And I started to say no. I just got to n, didn't get to the o, and he picked this thing up by the skin of its back, and he pushed against my chest. So my right arm around its rib cage and my left arm around its neck, I was standing there. But the point was, the lion had outgrown this stuff. It didn't want to be picked up anymore, and it indicated this to me by sinking its teeth into my arm. It wanted to be put down. I put it down. And that's how I was bitten by a lion. But it wasn't a lion cub, and it wasn't a full lion, or it'd be dead, or
and
at least it'd be one of
them. You were gushing?
I was bleeding, yes.
Did you get stitches?
Can you see?
Well, I see a scar, yeah.
Between this park and British Airways, I really hope you never have to work another day in your life.
Well, not in South Africa, yeah. So, and I went back. All these, strange. That was the true story.
But
and there are pictures.
There's proof.
We gotta get those.
Yeah.
We gotta get those.
Could you see them on rabbiyyy.com?
No, because the lady who's got them, who's in South Africa, whose daughter lives here in Far Rockaway, she's been promising me for 20 years to give me the pictures, and she still hasn't got them. But she's, when I was there last time, 2 years ago, for the Sana in Daba, she said, oh, I found the pictures the other day. I'll get them for you. Never did. Well, what can you do?
We'll get right back to that episode, guys. But two things that are very important to me, and Yaakov, you can tell me if you agree, are privacy and simplicity.
I disagree. I agree.
Okay, you agree. So the option to go with when it comes to a pharmacy is somebody that gives you the proper privacy and someone who you can work with
in a simple manner.
Do you guys know where he's going with this?
If you know where I'm going with this, say it with me.
AMR Pharmacy. Heck yeah.
They're simple. They make sure you got your medications before you even realize that you need to refill them. And Yaakov is holding in his hand
some M&Ms. For those of you who are just listening, listen to that sound. That's the sound of the future of medication. They have these single packs as well as these blister packs, and they do all the work for you. They put in exactly what you need. They find out what you need. You don't take the wrong medications. Easy to use. You just pop them.
And especially if you have parents or elderly family members that rely on you for maybe sorting out their pills or relying on someone else, AMR Pharmacy takes over that position. They make sure that it gets sent to you in a, sent to you or your family member in a way that it doesn't need to be played with. It's there in a safe manner.
So give them a call. Their number is 848-222-1110. Yeah, I have a terrible memory, but I remember that number by heart by now. 848-222-1110. Or you could go online, amrpharmrx.com. That's amrpharmrx.com. Guys, you've heard us mention it so many times. Use them, please.
Enjoy the rest of the episode.
So we want to talk to you about you were the campus rabbi. I don't know how to properly say campus rabbi.
Well, the official title was student chaplain.
You're the student chaplain.
Student chaplain for the 14 universities of the northwest of England, Manchester and Liverpool and places like that.
For 25 years,
I looked after 3,000 students. For 25 years, every year 3,000 students.
Every year another 3,000.
Yeah, another 3,000.
Okay, Yaakov, quick
math. See, those are actually very interesting because
quick math, Yaakov.
That's 400 million. Wow.
400. Yeah, good. Atlantic. Atlantic Ocean. 400 million.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you're doing fine. The interesting thing was the job, which I loved, was very important. See, if you can get to a person when they're your age, young.
Your age? You said your age?
Your age.
When he's looking at our
age? Your age, yeah. Okay. Youngsters, boys.
Oh, okay. Well,
but if you can help somebody when they're young, that's the most effective. And if you can interest them in their religion when they're young, because young people are interested in experimentation. They're open-minded. Yeah. When they leave university, they've got a career, they've got a job. No time to change. No time to think. Just got to make money and settle into a career, and they're more or less stuck for life. But at a stage in life where a person can still change is university. Before that, preferably, actually. Also, NCSY, great organization. The work they do with kids before they get to college, that's really the ideal stage to help. But anyway, my job was not just doing Jewish stuff. It was also, I was the official guy. So if there was any problems at university, anti-Semitism, from other students or from the staff, then my job was to fight. And that's when my Scottish background came in very nicely.
Right.
I don't mind a fight in a good cause, and I'm not looking for a fight, but if one comes up, I don't mind fighting. And in my 25 years, I never lost one.
When you say fight, what do you mean? Like,
if there's any anti-Semitism.
There's like a fist fight going on?
No. Sometimes. but no, seriously, if there was an issue like very often exams would clash with the Jewish holiday.
Mm.
Manchester Medical School, Manchester Dental School had a big strain of anti-Semitism going through it, often from Jews. Especially in medicine, you have to be 100% committed to medicine and nothing else.
Mm,
it's a thing. Right. So if you wanted to, so Manchester University for many, many years operated a system where if a student took time off for Yom Kippur, something as piddling and irrelevant as Yom Kippur, then that went down in your records and you would not get an honors. So I went to war over that, and the university was not. Oh, that's so kind of you.
And it's still working.
Yes. Gravity.
Yeah.
Trying to do it like secretly nonchalantly.
Yeah,
No, super nonchalant. Yeah, no. Start moving wires.
Because I'm tied up with all these wires by my foot.
So if a student wanted time off for Yom Kippur, they would penalize them and it would reflect on the quality of the degree that they got. And that's actually where my BBC stuff came in, because I used to be really quite well known in the UK, and sort of like people would come up to me in the street and say, "Are you a famous voice?" Because they'd recognize my voice. And of course, occasionally if I was on TV, people would recognize me there as well. So the university was not being very helpful. Of course, the medical school is part of the university. And then I had a meeting with what's called the proctor, who's like the director of the university. And suddenly he was all over me like a blanket. Oh, this is terrible. And he couldn't have been more helpful. And at the end of the meeting, he said, when I was driving here to the university today, I was listening to the BBC. I said, oh, yeah. You'll never guess who I heard. I said, who? I know exactly who now. And he said, you. And I said, oh, really? He said, you were on this big BBC news program. You were on the Today program. And I said, yeah. Do you do that a lot? I said, yes, regularly. And he actually said, I won't be in next week's Valet. And I said, oh, I wouldn't dream of mentioning what we're doing here. You know, of course I would. Anyway, that was that. And that was the
last issue.
And he was completely on my side. And the medical school.
You could have just stayed home for the rest of the year.
So that was actually very, very useful. So I looked after Jewish students and, of course, was very involved in Jewish education. And I used to take students away for, you know, Shabbatons into the countryside, in a place called the Lake District, England's Lake District, which is very famous, which is, you know, you can achieve so much more when you take somebody out of their natural environment.
Right.
For a Shabbaton somewhere particularly nice. So I raised all the money. I used to raise all my funds, didn't tell you this bit, with an annual whiskey tasting event in the House of Commons.
That sounds so non-American.
Yes, the House of Commons, where William Wallace, in the room where William Wallace was found guilty of treason and executed, if you've ever seen the film. He was a real person. And as opposed to the anti-Semitic little squirt who portrayed him in the, he's tiny, that fellow, Mel Gibson.
He's not like Jews, that guy.
Whereas, William Wallace was 6'4", if I remember rightly. The real one.
Interesting.
So you did a fundraiser for...
I used to raise all the my own funds, and I'm very lucky because our family have been in Scotland for 125 years. And 25 years ago, was it 25 years ago? About then, there was a gathering in Edinburgh, the capital of Scotland, of the family to celebrate 100 years. A letter from the Queen. To the brochure that was prepared. I was supposed to go to speak because I was the family rabbi. Unfortunately, my late wife, Les Shalom, had cancer. I just received chemotherapy or radiotherapy, but you weren't allowed to be next to people. So we didn't actually get to go, but there's a brochure. I should have brought it along to show you. When Margaret Thatcher was the prime minister, four members of her cabinet were Jews, and they were all cousins. So the family originally comes from Lithuania, and came to Scotland and settled there very nicely. But now it's spread out, of course, all over the world, including quite a few in America.
I have a feeling you're going to say at the end, like, one of the things I said was made up. You guys have to figure out what it is. There's so many interesting things.
So you're not just English. You were very much English.
Well, I wasn't English at all. I'm Scottish.
You're
British, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We got it.
Yeah, so, no, there Britain, no,
yeah,
you're,
there you go.
You're in serious
trouble. You were born in Zimbabwe.
Yeah.
No, but like you didn't just, you know, grow up there and just leave. You were a big part of
European, like, culture.
European culture, yes. British culture. So you moved here?
Well, why did I move here? I moved here for a job for an organization, which turned out not to be an organization, to work for a rabbi, turned out not to be a rabbi, and for a job that was supposed to last three years,
it on Craigslist?
And lasted 10 months. Yeah. Okay. How did you do that? Yeah. Yeah, I think it was www.stupidjobsinamerica.com. I moved here for a job. My wife's American. I remarried after my wife passed away. In fact, my late wife made me promise to remarry and even suggested who.
Really? And is that who you got remarried
to? Yeah.
Well, your late wife made your shit up.
Yes.
Hold on, I want to talk about that. So how long were you married for?
26 years.
Wow. And what? And was it sudden that your wife passed away?
No, she had cancer for 5 years.
For 5 years.
Breast cancer. And then we should point out that so many people who have died then, even in such a short space of time, of breast cancer, that don't die today.
What year was this?
So that was, it's 15 years ago.
15 years ago.
So 2005.
And you're saying that...
So I guess, the medicine has advanced so much since then.
So what was
that? One of my books is on this subject.
Yeah, you wrote a whole book, a little book.
The Little Book for Big Worries. In fact, just today somebody phoned me up to would I speak in England? Many of the Jewish cancer things, cancer charities, I'm involved with, and as somebody phones me up whenever there is a case that somebody who likes me or knows me or hears my shirim, could I speak to them? So there's a lady, sadly, I heard who's not well, and she wanted to speak to me. So yeah, and I told her to get hold of my little book for big worries, and I sort of give them out as well, and they've helped thousands of people, which is. There was one, you know, the funny thing is a funny Jewish thing. The book, the title is The Little Book for Big Worries, and the subtitle is, on the cover, Dealing with Serious Illness. And because Jews are very superstitious, and I sold almost none in the stores, because people picked up, saw the word illness, and dropped it. However, there's almost none left, because people who were sick, now the book is written for people looking after people who are not well. Mm. But people who are not well who got copies, it really spoke to them. So there was one guy, sadly, he's now passed away, who had cancer in Brooklyn. Nice fellow, he used to come to my shirim. He got a copy, and somebody gave it to him, not me, as before I knew him, actually. And he went out and bought 50 copies. And he was at Sloan Kettering having his treatments. He simply went around the chemotherapy room, saying to people, are you Jewish, are you Jewish, and giving out copies. After he'd given away 50, bought another 50. By the time the poor fellow passed away, if I remember rightly, he'd given away 500 copies of the book.
Wow.
And wherever I go, honestly, there's almost inevitably somebody's going to come up and say, I want to thank you for that book. It helped me so much, et cetera, et cetera. So that book was, hugely helpful.
If you're able, are you able to, you know, I know it's impossible to really sum up the book in a sentence or an idea, but what does that book do for people that are looking after people who are sick or for people who are sick themselves?
Well, there's three chapters. I think three chapters. It's a very small book. The idea was to make it very accessible. You could carry it with you easily to the hospital and with very simple messages. The theme that runs through it is hope. Jews exist on hope or we wouldn't be here. Think of our history. You know, Crusades, Inquisition, you know, well, we're coming up to Tisha B'Av, you know, right. All that stuff. We're only here because we hope, sometimes ridiculously so, but we hope. A big theme in the book, I think it's two chapters, and I don't think it was intentional, just the way it wrote. Books often write themselves, by the way. But anyway, so is the idea of words, bearing in mind what we are doing now, words count. Words are very important. Say the right words, you can give life to somebody. Say the wrong words, and you can kill them. And that's quite serious. I said this to this lady today. I said, let me give you a piece of advice that I received when my wife was first diagnosed by a very good family friend in Jerusalem, Rebbetzin Gottlieb Alei Shalom. She phoned up and she said, lots of very good people are going to say very stupid things to you. Don't get upset. Keep an idiot book. Right? And instead of being upset and angry, how could they say that? How could they be so tactless? You just go, you're in the idiot book. And it helps. So there was a lady come up to my wife right at the beginning of her story and said, you know, Mrs. Cohen had the same disease as you. And she got a bracha from a tzaddik that she should live long enough to see all of her children married under the chuppah. Why are you marrying your children off so quickly? Wow! Brilliant! You're in the idiot book! And she got in there, you know, for she was at the top of the hip read for about 6 months. And then somebody else said something.
And you're right for sick for 5 years. I'm sure there's a lot of
all good people, by the way.
Yeah.
This lady who said this was a very nice person.
Well-meaning, you know.
Yeah, so words. So there's two chapters emphasizing how to speak to people who are not well, to avoid saying the wrong things, which will make them feel...
What are five do's and five don'ts of speaking to people who are sick?
Always be positive. Always refer to people who you know who had the same disease and who are alive 20 years later.
Mm. Don't give examples of people who are no longer. He had it, but he passed away last week.
That's right. No, I mean, it sounds common sense, but people say that sort of thing. Don't say the word remission. They're in remission. Remission means it's on the way back.
Mm.
Right? Say that people are cured. Talk about people who are cured. Very important. I had my wife had a cousin, and she was called Auntie Dora. Auntie Dora had cancer 4 times. Breast, brain, kidney, skin, if I remember rightly. 4 different cancers. She died at 75 of a heart attack.
Whoa.
When she was in the hospital being treated for cancer, not only did a doctor come with a couple of medical students to see her, scores arrived because she was a medical phenomenon.
The fact that she survived four times.
She survived these things, yeah. There is, I mean, there's a beautiful story. I'm involved, as I said, with various cancer charities in England, and something called Camp Simcha, which everybody's heard about, the English Camp Simcha. How did it start? Because a wonderful fellow called Nir Plancy, whose father is also a Scottish rabbi, who plays the bagpipes.
Yeah, very
good. He does them very well.
It sounds exactly like that. Wow.
Yeah. It's not bagpipes in here, by the way. Everyone should know that was my voice.
That was his voice.
I'm very good at that. Yeah.
Yeah, very good. anyway, so that was not the bagpipe. Okay. So basically, he was in a yeshiva called Medrash Shmuel. A fabulous yeshiva.
Yeah, it's all around Medrash, right? It's referred to as Medrash.
Right, and the Rosh Yeshiva is an old friend of mine. We used to say shiram together, Oxford and Cambridge universities. Rabbi Milman Moskowitz knows about tough times. He lost four children in a fire.
Oh.
A year later, his wife had a baby, a little baby called her, of course, Nechama. She died 11 months later in a crib death. Hmm. And about 10 months ago, a 35-year-old daughter died, leaving a five-year-old child. He sat shiva for six children.
My God. Right?
I mean, he knows, you know, about this sort of stuff. Anyway, when Mayor Plancy was in that yeshiva, he was staying with the family, and the five-year-old child got a very aggressive brain tumor. There's nothing you could do about the child, you know, helping the child with the surgery or the chemo radiotherapy. But between treatments, he used to read to the child and take the child places, and he was wonderful. When he came back to England, he was supposed to get and start, you know, a career in business. But instead, he thought to himself, I wonder if I could transfer what I did there. So he started supporting five families who had a sick child. This today is an organization that employs 42 people, looks after thousands of families. I've spoken for them several times, love it. They've got a camp for children with cancer and another camp retreat for children with worse diseases than cancer, because there are lots of cancers that are curable in children. Anyway, so basically, 5 years ago, it was the 20th anniversary of Camp Simcha in the UK. There was a big dinner, 1,400 people, huge gala dinner. And the Plancys, Mr. and Mrs. Plancy, did not know that their employees had got together and contacted every single family over the 20 years that they had helped and supported. Got them to write something in a book with a picture and a little story. And they brought the family that Mayor had been supporting, or had stayed with and was supporting, that little first little child with the aggressive brain tumor when it was five, to present the book to him and his wife. And the person in the family did it with that little boy, who with the aggressive brain tumor, 20 years later, now a man of 25, married. That's the sort of story you have to tell to remind people who are really struggling. But as one of my students put it, and I put it in the book, the thing is that doctors think they're gods, and people forget that God's a doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's the sort of thing you have to say.
I love that. That's so nice.
And for those, I guess, who are caring for, whether it's a sibling, a parent, whoever it is,
right,
you were caring for your wife for 5 years when she was sick. Is there something you would tell that person?
Yeah, there's a lot. There's chapters in the book about that as well. You have to look after yourself. You're not going to be able to look after them if you're not looking after yourself.
You gotta put on your own oxygen mask first, almost.
Absolutely. Exactly. That's the thing. Sometimes when I was in the hall, I don't know. I mean, we talked about me nearly dying. One day I'll be standing in front of the heavenly court, like we all will. And I'm not looking forward to this at all. However, I can tell you honestly, the 5 years from my wife's diagnosis to when she passed away, I think I'm going to get 100% as a husband. I was with her when she was diagnosed. I was with her when she passed away. I was with her every single hospital treatment except one, where I sent my son. Can't remember why I wasn't able to be there. I got that right. That bit I got right.
Mm-hmm.
So one thing very important for carers, sometimes, you know, I'd be in hospital with her in a hospital room, you know, and it's a cancer hospital. and I'd be there for 3 days, you know, 2 days Yom Tov and Shabbos. At the end of it, I had cabin fever. I mean, you literally, yeah. You know, you're, and she would say, no, go and, well, one of my sons would come and look, because we were with all the time. You won't get a break. So I would drive to the Lake District, which is an hour north of Manchester. Very beautiful, much nicer than the Catskills, but near, like the Catskills, just to recharge my batteries. Because if you're not looking after yourself, you can't look after anybody else. There's a lot of that in the book as well.
So you strike me as a person that, and I think you have a book on it also, that you're very into humor, you're very into laughter, you're very into positivity and hope. What I wouldn't have known, I think a lot of times you meet someone and if a family member died, you kind of get a sense of it somewhat. With you, I don't really feel that. How?
Well,
I'm not saying that, like, Kassar, your wife's not forgotten at all, no, but, of course, yeah. But you're so positive, though, just in life. Like, what are you doing different? Is there a method to, like...
Yeah, I mean, yeah. There. Sorry, it sounds like the one big advertisement.
No, plug away anything. Plug away, this is not...
So
this is
real. I, one of my books that came out, 2016, I think. 2016. Brought two books out this in 2016. One's called Jewish Life and Jewish Laughter, which deals with the whole life cycle of a Jew, from that when you're that size to when you're that size, and all the big challenges you face in life. So it's actually a serious book, lots of Torah in it, but I put in all the funny stuff that happened to us going through all those stages.
Right.
Fine. At the same time, I brought out a book which is called Refuas HaLev, a new translation of Shara B'tochen of the Chovas Levavos. I thought that the funny book would fly off the shelves. And this, which is really a safer, so it's a brand new translation. It's got the Hebrew beside it and a very long commentary by me, you know, and explanations as we go along. I thought that would be in the shelves for the next 10 years and the funny book would be gone in a second. It was the opposite. In 18 months, 5,000 copies of the serious book went. And the funny book, I can still, you know, I've still got copies to sell. And the, one of the reasons I wrote that was because of my own experience of my own tough times. I wish, although I dipped into it, but I wish I knew that book well, because it's about building a relationship with God by having bitachon, having real trust, or a better translation, having real certainty in God, means that when bad and tough times come along, you're prepared and they're not as tough. I say, I wish growing up that book was on my bookshelves and I knew it well. Excuse me. Ramatziel Solomon, in his, because he brought a book in the same topic, he said if Shara B'tochen had not been written, it would have to have been developed as a therapy. And one of my big ambitions was that young people would read it. And it's interesting, I'm involved with an organization in New York, which I'm very proud of, called Lynx, which is set up for girls, no boys too, but girls who've lost a parent. Set up by a Hasidish lady who lost her mother when she was 10, Sarah Rivka Kahn and her husband. Now they've got, I think, 5,000 girls on the books, which is a lot, you know, a lot. Interestingly, those girls, they devour this book. I've given Shirim on the book. They've got copies. They learn it in Chaburas. They learn it in Chaburas. It's very important in life. I mean, you don't have to buy my translation, although I think it's excellent.
Which you can buy on rabbiyyy.com.
Which you can buy, exactly, rabbiyyy.com. But seriously, if you could just get that book, and particularly in young people. Because if you think, look, I'll give you a simple example. You see, in the old days, when doctors used to come and do house calls. Have you heard about this?
Yes.
Have you read about it in the history books?
Yes.
But they used to. If you see a doctor's car, he's doing a house call outside the house because he's visiting an 8-year-old. Well, the kid's got mumps, measles. When you see the doctor's car outside somebody who's 70, it's a heart attack or something bad. Generally, life's pretty good for most kids, at least I hope it is. But as you get older, then life gets a bit more complicated, a bit tougher. It's good to be prepared before the tough times. You want to know how to swim before you fall off the boat, how to land before you jump out of a, you know, with a parachute from a plane, and how to get from the bottom of the of the sea when your air runs out, as mine did in Florida a couple of years ago, without killing yourself. So yeah, the books. Oh, so I don't know. I think I've got a sense of humor. I think it's the classic thing is that you either are a good fighter or you develop a sense of humor to avoid getting into fights. I'm an only child, or as I like to think of myself, unique. No siblings. And that was a problem growing up in a non-Jewish, violent Glasgow, as I did, going to a non-Jewish school.
You had to fend for yourself.
Yeah, and I didn't, you know
like that?
Jewish kid. No. It was tough. Very tough. So you develop a sense of humor. And you don't do it consciously. It just happens, I think. So, yeah. And I'm quite jolly, I suppose, by nature. I'm quite positive. But I work at it. I wrote that book. I've actually discovered, having given about 3,000 shirim on the subject and written the translation, some of the ideas are actually starting to get into my mind. Incredible. And that helps to keep me jolly as well.
You mentioned the scuba. Well, what's the scuba story? You have like all elements, the sky, beasts, water.
You're in Florida on the bottom of coral reef.
Yeah, I just ran out of air. Bit of a bummer, that one. But I managed to get to the top.
Who needs air, right?
Just, yeah, luxury. Yeah, that's for wimps. I can hold my breath for hours. Yeah, I just ran out of air.
And
scuba diving, I've always...
And it was a nace, or like...
Oh, no, it was an... No,
his whole life is a nace.
The problem was, if you know anything about scuba diving, you have to have weights with you.
Weights.
Pacific or Atlantic?
So, weight, because you want what's called neutral buoyancy, right? You don't want to go, and you want to go down. So you have weights, which relates to your size and your physical weight, because your lungs are full of air. So that makes you buoyant. So you've got to compensate for that. They didn't give me enough weights to get to the bottom. So I'm bobbing up and down on the surface. I couldn't dive. And it took me about 15 minutes for them to see me and bring me some new weights, which meant I could dive. Meanwhile, I'd used up a very great deal of air bobbing up and down on the surface. Anyway, by the time I got down, I was there for about 10 minutes and I noticed that I was running out of air. And so I just made it to the surface and no more. I love scuba diving. And
really?
Yeah, and you're bearing in mind, there's a very famous Reb Shamshon Raphael Hirsch writes.
Oh, I thought you were going to say he likes scuba diving also.
Yeah, he used to go all the time. Reb Shamshon Raphael Hirsch, the Chassadik Livrochon, says very interestingly that when you get upstairs, we sing to his congregation, I suppose, Hashem's going to say to you, "Did you go and see my Alps?" The Alps are mountains.
I know, oh my gosh.
In a country called Switzerland, Germany, Austria, and Italy.
That part, I didn't know.
Border of the... Oh, okay. The stunning. Absolutely stunning. And I speak as somebody Scottish, because we have got really good mountains.
I think I've seen them on the chocolate bar wrapper.
Yeah, chocolate bar. That's, that's it. Good.
I'm from New York. Alpine, that's from New York.
Anyway, so basically said, "Have you gone to see my Alps?" And Dovid HaMelech says, "Hashemayim Misapirim Kvod Kel," the heaven, the universe shows you. You get a taste of Hashem from the beauty of the, certainly from the beauty of the Alps. Alps are stunning, no doubt about it. Anyway, so basically, if you bear in mind that 3/4 of the world's surface is under the seas, then if you really want to get a taste of the beauty and the incredibleness of what Hashem did, you've got to go under as well.
It's a mitzvah.
It's a mitzvah. So that's why I go scuba diving.
Hey, listen. Plan your trip to Cuba. It's a mitzvah.
which leads us to our next question. Do you have a favorite mitzvah?
Do I have a favorite mitzvah? Yes. Teaching Torah. I like teaching.
Teaching.
I like people, actually.
Is people a mitzvah?
Yeah, I think so. I think people are chesed. I like people. Even though I don't like traveling so much anymore, because I find as one gets, as you get older, recovering from jet lag takes longer. It's not so much fun. But I love meeting new people and like meeting people. So I like teaching.
Do any of the experiences that you've, I guess, that we've discussed over the last 55 minutes or so, has it ever held you back from doing, have you stopped flying? Have you stopped going scuba diving, holding lions?
Yeah, I don't hold lions too much anymore.
Like, have you stopped flying since you had...
Oh, no. No. Not at all.
I imagine, I don't know, like that's, how do you get back onto a plane?
You know, it's in the hands of Hashem anyway.
Really?
You've got to do your Hishtadlus.
If it says
the fourth chapter, the fourth chapter of Shaar B'Tochen, yeah, you've got to do, you take reasonable precautions. But otherwise, and particularly in COVID and all this stuff, you know, you can make yourself, there's an interesting story. An interesting story, which I saw somewhere at the beginning of the COVID crisis of a, I can't remember where I saw this. But anyway, so some rabbi, one day he was walking along the road and he meets the angel of death. Hi, he said. Where are you off to? I'm off to that town over there. Oh, why? I've got to take some guys. How many taking? I think he said it was 2,000. Right, okay. But 10,000 people died. So he bumps into the angel of death sometime after. He said, you lied to me. What are you talking about? I'm an angel, I don't lie. So what are you talking about? He said, you said you take 2,000. 10,000 died. No, I only took 2,000. The other 8,000 died from worry. Mm. They worried themselves to death. And there's a very important thing there. You know, you've got to be, as the Rambam says, the middle derech. You've got to be balanced about this stuff. You've got to be normal. Don't take excessive risks, but don't make yourself excessively nuts over this stuff. What's the reasonable thing to do? The reasonable thing is to, you know, most planes don't crash.
You're just extremely lucky.
Yeah, yeah. Although I should tell you, the guy on the plane, who I was sitting beside when we got off the plane, I said, do you mind if I ask your name? You know, I want to know how I nearly died with. He said, oh, I've been in six of these.
Oh.
He'd been in six crash landings.
He's like, oh, no, not again. No. I wouldn't want to fly next to that guy.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, that's what I want to know.
Please
his name
tell
for.
Us
yeah.
his name.
No, thank you.
If you see him
yes, that's right.
boarding a flight, you know, that's honey, right. we're going home.
Not wanted. Not wanted posters all over the airports. This is the guy you don't want yeah. to be sending.
This guy like, walking the plane, the stewardess is like, oh, man.
If you could time travel.
Yes.
And go back in time.
Again?
I guess always because you yeah, always yeah. had that capability. Yeah.
It's funny, you asked me this question 200 years ago.
I'm going to ask it in 400 years yeah, also. Yeah. And you could sit down with someone from the past who's no longer with us and
yeah. spend an hour with them.
Yeah.
Who would it be?
Oh, my dad.
Your dad?
Oh, it's funny. It never occurred to me. Gosh, I did.
You did?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Oh, yeah. It's going to sound very weird.
And that's enough time for the podcast. Thanks everyone for coming. Yeah, you're.
Yeah, actually, a very strange thing. My dad died Purim morning when I was 18. I was in shul.
Gosh.
My dad died from his 21st heart attack, and so he was at home. He wasn't feeling well, and like a message, this was before cell phones, but somebody came to say, "Your dad's not well. You should go home." In actual fact, he died. Anyway, so that was that. So 2 years ago,
that was that. Like he died.
Oh, he died.
I mean,
oh no,
21 heart attacks.
Sorry,
20. You said 21.
20. He'd been dead twice. Four times he died, and they brought him back. But this time he was dying.
So he passed away. You were 18.
18.
I didn't even know that bad.
You had 21 heart attacks and you were 18.
Yeah. Like, oh, yeah. Yeah, it's interesting because, well, the story I'm about to tell you brought the whole thing back to me that I really wasn't aware that my whole childhood was dominated by the fact my father was ill, you know, because he kept having heart attacks.
I'm guessing he had heart condition.
Yeah, he had heart condition. Yeah. I had a stent in my heart 3 years ago. If they had stents in those days, probably my dad would have been, you know. Anyway. Yeah. Gosh, he died as a young man. I think he was 52.
That is young.
Yeah, yeah.
So a few weeks ago, what were you?
Oh,
doing?
So 2 years ago, I was in yeshiva. I was learning with Machav Rusa, Rabbi Young, and I got this terrible muscle seizure in my back, agony. And I went, oh, and I jumped up. Shor Yoshuv jumped up. And he said, "You okay?" I said, "Yeah." I just and it's sort of like eased up, and I sat down again. That came me again. Oh, so now I gotta go. So I went home and I lay down in bed, and I just waited for it to ease up. Beside my bed was my iPad. And so I picked it up and I was looking emails and stuff and I went to YouTube. And on YouTube, it sort of flashes up things. And there was a film then, I think it was 2 years ago, called Dunkirk.
Yeah.
It was a big movie.
Chris
and
Nolan.
This was a reenaction of the fact that the British army were trapped on the beaches of Dunkirk by the advancing German army. And a miracle happened. It was a miracle. That all the ordinary little people in Britain at the south coast who had boats crossed the channel, I think it's only 25 miles between England and France, and the sea was like totally can. And they were able to bring them across. Fine, that's what the film is about. So they were sort of like advertising this movie. I wasn't interested in the movie, not very interested in movies. And but there was, beside it, there was a documentary about the real thing, BBC documentary. So I'm interested in history. History I enjoy very much. So I was watching this, lying there, couldn't move. And after about 20 minutes, it all eased up. I thought, you know what? Fine. So I went downstairs, and I was making myself some soup, stirring the pot, and I had my iPad there. I was watching this. Now, they had a picture of a train coming into a station with British soldiers on. Now, I've made films with the BBC. What you do is, as a filmmaker, you just, you know, you send to the library, I need some film of soldiers on trains. It was supposed to be soldiers coming back from being picked up and brought across. And they were saying how the soldiers thought that the people would hate them, that they were cowards, that they'd get beaten, but in fact, they got a very warm reception. So I was stirring the soup, and it was just, in came this train to the station, and there was a film camera there. And there was my dad. I'm telling you, even now, I'm tearing up. I couldn't believe it. It was just 2 seconds, and there he was standing there at the door, with his mustache, and his smile. It's my dad. Started to cry. I shouted, I'd seen my dad, now this was something like, you know, 42 years. And it was my dad. I was so moved. And I got the film, and I sent to all my kids, go to YouTube, and this document, whatever it's called, I said, and then go, advance it there. That's my dad. And I was, and I realized how much I missed him. And it'd be nice. It'd be nice to see. I always thought it would be nice for him to see the man that I grew up to be and meet his grandsons and granddaughters. So I'm getting all teary. Sorry, guys. But I'd like to see my dad again.
What would you talk to him about?
Oh, everything.
Anyone else you'd want to sit down with?
Nah.
Just him?
Yeah. I don't think I'd like... I've thought about this a lot. I wouldn't like to know who... What comes next? I certainly wouldn't like to know anybody from the future. I wouldn't want to be spoiled. And anyway, you're here for your challenges and the challenges that come in life. And if anybody gave you a hint, you know, I wouldn't like to go and see myself in 10 years' time and say, you know, how did it go? No, I've got to pass the test myself. So I wouldn't like to do that. From the past, the thing about the past is there's a Rashi in Pasha Shoftim. Go to the judges in your days. And Rashi says it's the way of stupid people to think that the rabbis and the dayanim that we have today are not up to the standards of the rabbis of the past. Now, that's obviously true at one level. I mean, who can compare to the Vilna Gaon? But if the Vilna Gaon came back today, or the Chofetz Chaim came back today, or Rosh Hashanah Shavuot Her today would come back today, he's no good to us. You need the gedayanim of your time, because their time is different. The challenges of their time are different. It was a different world. It's always a different world. So I'm not sure how much I would have to say, or they would have too much to say to me. The Rambam is a totally different world. So I'm really quite happy where I am. But if I could see one person talk to one person, oh my dad.
I think that story is so beautiful, but like that, it kind of feels like of the best gifts Hashem could give someone, like you didn't imagine you'll see your father again, and then...
Oh, it was astonishing. I know you tell me, you can see I still get very emotional about this. It was just because... You know, it was so much that was going to happen in my life, and so much, hopefully, I've done that's good. Hopefully. Stupid things as well. But, you know, he missed that.
Yeah.
And incidentally, as a teenager, often I didn't get on with my dad. And maybe that's part of it. You know, I'd like my dad to have seen, you know.
Do you go back and watch that clip on YouTube at all?
Or? Not so often. I mean, I did it about 2 months ago. I went back to see it, and it was incredible. Just very moving. I can't quite put it into words, because I didn't know it existed.
Right.
You
know,
and I don't think we had any cine cameras growing up, and there he was.
Is there any last message you want to give to our audience listening? You've said so many powerful, beautiful things.
Yeah, okay, so... Even though I said I speak all over the world, and I've been doing that for a very long time, I speak to lots of people, I only really speak about two things. And so I want to give
because I'm old. I'm older now. I want to give you some advice, guys.
You're not, for those listening, he's not old at all.
Still got red in his beard.
Oh, yeah, red. Good. I want to tell you guys some real advice here. You know, I was talking about this to somebody the other night. I play the guitar very badly. And the reason I play it very badly is because I taught myself. And you can always tell somebody who taught themselves because they don't hold it. Their left hand, if they're right-handed, they don't, the fingering, they don't hold it for chords properly. The thumb comes over the top. It shouldn't. It should be like that. Pressed against the underside of the guitar, which allows your fingers to come over and make, you know, stretch and make nice chords. So I don't hold it properly. If you want to learn to play the guitar properly, get a teacher. And if you want to learn mathematics properly, get a good math teacher. If you want to learn how to ice skate properly, get a good teacher. And if, because otherwise you'll make mistakes. Well, the most important thing, most important project in your life is your life. So for that, you certainly need a teacher. So it says in the beginning of Pirkei Avos, Asa L'chorav, get for yourself a teacher, get a Rebbe. It's in the masculine, incidentally, Asa L'chorav. So it's talking to men. The feminine version should be Asa L'chorav, and a woman will find better advice from another woman. But get yourself a mentor and get yourself a good teacher, a Torah personality, because everything's in the Torah. Fochba, fochba, dekolba. Turn the Torah over and turn it over again. It says Ben Bag Bag in the fifth parak, because everything's there. And don't try and solve problems in your life yourself, because you don't see yourself objectively. So the best piece of advice I could ever give anybody, as it says in Pirkei Avos, get yourself a teacher and start working on the most important project in your life. Your life.
Rabbi YY, you are awfully good.
You're very kind, both of you. It's been very enjoyable.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, let me tell all of you guys a secret. Kind of our goal is to, if we get someone to cry in the episode, not get them to cry, but if they start crying, we're like, okay, we hit a right emotional
Yaakov
moment.
And I go out to eat for dinner that night.
Yeah, that is true. We have other methods of making them cry. Like we could scream at them.
Or we could just make it really hot in here and just, you know, turn off the AC.
Yeah, that one. But that was really moving for me personally. After that episode, I went home. I'm like, wow, that was a really beautiful person and a really moving episode for me. Really.
No, I agree. He has so many amazing stories, so many amazing things happened to him.
I'm interrupting you, but we didn't even scratch the surface. Like, no, after we learned so many more interesting things about him.
We're definitely going to have to have another go at it with him, but you guys can check him out at rabbiyyy.com, I think it is.
Is it? I think I don't remember. We did this like a few weeks ago.
That might be. But coming soon, guys, the next episode is with Rabbi and Mrs. Bachner from Bonei Olam.
A double interview for our first one.
Yeah. So not double interview. It's one interview, but we had two guests.
Yes. Thank you for that clarification.
Very, very interesting. Amazing conversation. Hope you enjoyed this episode. Make sure to subscribe if you're not already subscribed. And by the time you're listening to this, I just want to say that we have surpassed, or we have crossed, over 100,000 audio downloads on our podcast. So thank you all so much for sharing it, for leaving reviews, and for sticking with us through our crazy intros and outros. Ciao.